Good morning. I'm Jennifer Palmer, and I'll be your worship leader today. During the service, we recommend you have your Zoom screen set to speaker view. Common Ground is our celebration of worship for people of many paths who are gathering virtually to share in the responsible search for meaning and truth. Pathways is a warm and open community where all who come with open minds and kind hearts are welcome, regardless of ability, age, race, gender identity, or sexual orientation. We hope that all who join us today find this a safe place to worship. If you're visiting with us today, we welcome you to our virtual service and hope you can visit us in person when we can be together again. We're so glad you're here. Please feel free to introduce yourself in the chat. To send us a note about your visit and get more information, you can email us at office@pathwaysuu.org. We'd love to hear from you. Our opening song this morning is Come Sing a Song with Me. As we remain muted, please feel free to join in or just listen. As we virtually light our chalice this morning, please join me in these words. We light this chalice to affirm that new light is ever waiting to break through to enlighten our ways, that new truth is ever waiting to break through to illumine our minds, and that new love is ever waiting to break through to warm our hearts. May we be open to this light and to the rich possibilities that it brings us. I invite you now to join me in a renewal of our sacred promises. Please read along with me. Love is the doctrine of this church. The quest for truth is its sacrament, and service is its prayer. To dwell together in peace, to seek knowledge and freedom, to serve human need to the end that all souls shall grow in harmony with the divine. Thus do we covenant with each other. Now I'd like to welcome our speaker for today, Lee Legault. Lee works as a hospital chaplain resident in Austin and looks forward to her September 18th, 2021 ordination as a UU minister at First Unitarian Universalist Church of Austin. She practiced law in the areas of civil defense litigation and appeals for 15 years before heeding her call to be a different kind of counselor. She earned her Master of Divinity and Master of Social Work degrees in May 2020.
Thank you, Jennifer. Our reading from today is from the poem, A Great Wagon, by Rumi, a 13th century Persian poet and Sufi mystic. Out beyond ideas of wrongdoing and rightdoing, there is a field. I'll meet you there. When the soul lies down in that grass, the world is too full to talk about. Ideas, language, even the phrase each other doesn't make any sense. The breeze at dawn has secrets to tell you. Don't go back to sleep. People are going back and forth across the door sill where two worlds touch. The door is round and open. Don't go back to sleep.
Thank you, Lee. Our worship song for today is Though I May Speak with Bravest Fire.
I've spent the last 3 months working as a hospital chaplain. I spend 12 hours a week in a virtual classroom learning the principles and theories of chaplaincy, and I spend the other 40 hours a week applying what I've learned and building my skills working with patients. More even than I'm learning, though, I'm unlearning. I'm unlearning ways of being and communicating that I've been inundated with since birth and that I honed to a razor's edge in my law practice. My old way of communicating involved judgment, persuasion, reasoning, logic, head and intellect-based skills. In my new world, I use heart-based skills. I speak little and I listen a lot. And in doing so, I ignore red herrings of judgments and evaluations, and I listen for the feelings and the needs underneath them. People open up their lives to me when I communicate this way and share their innermost selves, gifts I hold sacred. It's in this kind of communication, I don't even so much communicate as commune. On the night of September 29th, 2020, I was on call at the hospital. And in between patient emergencies, I watched snatches of the first presidential debate. And I read chapters in the book that my chaplain educators had assigned to me, Nonviolent Communication by Marshall Rosenberg. The contrast between what I saw on TV, experienced in patient rooms, and read in my book was so stark that it forced an unpleasant conclusion. My old way of being and communicating, it was fundamentally the same as what I was fuming at seeing in the presidential debate. My old way, it brought out or pointed out the worst in people, highlighting their flaws and their wrongness. My old way of communicating, I came to see, was frankly violent. White psychologist and peace activist Marshall Rosenberg, author of the book I was reading at the hospital that night, developed his practice of nonviolent communication in the 1960s as a tool to implement the desegregation of schools in the United States. He studied with a hero of mine, psychologist Carl Rogers, who was a founder of humanist psychology and the person-centered approach to therapy. Nonviolent communication, NVC for short, is really as much a spiritual practice as it is a communication style. It's based on the ancient Indian theological principle, ahimsa, the natural state of compassion when no violence is present in the heart. Ahimsa is a key virtue in Hinduism and Jainism. The symbol for ahimsa, the hand, was what you saw on the slide right before I started talking. And it deeply informed Gandhi's activism. Before one can practice NVC as a communication style, Rosenberg admonishes us, one must develop NVC as a consciousness and a spiritual intent. He says, most of us grew up speaking a language that encourages us to label, compare, demand, and pronounce judgments rather than to be aware of what we are feeling and needing. This life-alienating communication, it's rooted in views of human nature that have exerted their influence for several centuries. These views stress humans' innate evil and deficiency and the need for education to control our inherently undesirable nature. Such education often leaves us questioning whether there's something wrong with whatever feelings and needs we may be experiencing. We learn early to cut ourselves off from what's going on within ourselves. Life alienating communication both stems from and supports hierarchical or domination societies. Oops. Excuse me, I lost my other screen there for a minute. It would be in the interests of kings and czars that the masses be educated in a way that renders them essentially slave-like in mentality. Because the more people are trained to think in terms of moralistic judgments, of looking outside themselves and to outside authorities for the definition of what constitutes right, wrong, good, and bad, the more the people in control of the hierarchy remain in control. When we're in contact with our feelings and our needs, we humans no longer make good slaves and underlings, Rosenberg says. From a theological perspective, I think Rosenberg's theory of NVC requires buy-in on three beliefs. One, that people are at their core good and compassionate. Two, that there are universal human needs. And three, that we are interconnected beings, such that what we say and do to one another matters to all of us. Unitarian Universalism, it aligns with all three of these theological beliefs. Our first principle, the inherent worth and dignity of every person, shows UU alignment with the idea that people are good and compassionate beings, and that there is a spark of the divine in everyone, waiting to be recognized and addressed. Together, our second principle, justice, equity, and compassion in human relations, and our sixth principle, the goal of world community with peace, liberty, and justice for all, show UU alignment with the theological belief that there are universal human needs. Our seventh principle, respect for the interdependent web of existence of which we are all a part, shows alignment with the third theological principle of NVC, that what one of us says and does to another matters to all of us. Adopting nonviolent communication as a spiritual practice, well, it allows us to speak our principles into the world. The actual process of nonviolent communication has four parts. One, observe without evaluating. Two, express how you are feeling. Three, acknowledge the need behind that feeling. And four, make a request of the other that would enrich your life. Now, every one of these stages is rich with wisdom, but today we're going to focus on stages two and three, feelings and needs. The world mostly teaches us to stuff our feelings down or project them onto others or deceptively package our judgments about others as our own feelings. Growing up, I think I memorized more vocabulary related to geometric figures than I did feelings. And I find that trapezoids play a distinctly less critical role in my daily life than emotions. To develop NVC as a spiritual practice, I'm learning a whole new language of feeling words. During seminary, when I was studying Hebrew, I taped a piece of paper with the Hebrew alphabet to the inside of my medicine cabinet, and I looked at it while I was brushing my teeth. Now I have pages of feeling words taped up instead, and many of them are about as foreign to me as the Hebrew was. After our talk, we'll put a link to these lists of feeling words in the chat box so you can explore them a little bit more if you're interested. Maybe tape them up in your own medicine cabinet and practice with them. During the first presidential debate, which I think was about as violent a discussion as I've ever heard, I was struck by how angry both candidates seemed and how that anger was never directly named. I much preferred the tone and language of President-elect Biden's victory speech. I'll read some lines of it. See if you can hear the feeling words and register the feelings they evoke in you. I am humbled by the trust and confidence you have placed in me. I am proud of the campaign we built and ran. I'm proud of the coalition we put together, the broadest and most diverse in history. Talking about a hymn that means a lot to him. I hope it can provide some comfort and solace to the more than 230,000 families, now 300,000, who have lost a loved one to this terrible virus this year. And to those who voted for President Trump, I understand your disappointment tonight. Feelings form a foundation for real communication. Feelings connect us. Identifying our own feelings and expressing curiosity about the feelings of the other speaker, well, that honors the inherent worth and dignity of both parties as human beings. After identifying the feelings, the next step in nonviolent communication is identifying the universal need that underlies the feelings. Feelings never arise in isolation, you see. There's a cause for the feeling. And this part is both critical and I think really, really hard to keep in our minds. The words and actions of another person's cannot be the cause of our own feeling. Yes, a person's actions or words might stimulate a feeling in me, but that feeling, that's born of my own met or unmet needs. So I'll give you an example of that. I didn't feel exasperated during the first presidential debate because Donald Trump and Joseph Biden kept interrupting each other. I felt exasperated because my need for a sense of security and faith in our leaders went unmet when they continually spoke over each other. So connecting our own feelings to our own needs, that takes a lot of practice and it takes a lot of humility. But the thing is that it is the path to compassion. So as little as the world prepares us to name our own feelings, I would say it prepares us even less to name fundamental human needs. A few of these, Rosenberg would say, are love, acceptance, belonging, physical and emotional safety, peace, order, and meaning. And we'll put a link to the list of these needs in the chat box after the talk. One of the things that I love about our Unitarian Universalist principles is that they beautifully articulate fundamental human needs. So reread those. I think reread them weekly, but this week when you reread them, read with an eye for the fundamental needs that you see in there. And now with an ear to unmet needs, think back to the vice presidential debate. I remember Vice President-elect Kamala Harris said repeatedly, "Mr. Vice President, I am speaking." Now using NVC, she might have offered, "Mr. Vice President, I feel frustrated and irritated because my needs for respect and order are not being met when you interrupt me." I kind of wonder if her ratings would have suffered if she put it that way. And I kind of think they would have. Because our society, it's not set up to recognize or value clear and direct articulations of feelings and needs. And that's too bad. Because as Dr. Rosenberg puts it, the moment people begin talking about what they need, rather than what's wrong with one another or one another's positions, the possibility of finding ways to meet everybody's needs, it's greatly increased. Identifying the universal needs underlying both sides of an argument, it speeds positive change and transformation, regardless of whether the disagreement is how to spend the church budget or how to increase equity in American society. What people do or don't say, do or don't do about anything, that's about a need that is or isn't being met. Dr. Roxy Manning, a Black NVC certified trainer and a clinical psychologist, she writes about how NVC can be used towards racial justice. She says, "NVC invites us to look beneath the most heinous strategies and find the needs that those strategies were designed to meet. When we uncover the needs, we're not saying the strategies are okay. We're not saying gee, now that I know your intention, I forgive you. We can fully acknowledge the incredible loss and pain stimulated by certain strategies, working to stop the use of those strategies, while still seeing the needs that those strategies were trying to meet. And by seeing the need, we can then work towards new strategies that result in far less harm. If you want to show up and help, you can offer empathy that's grounded in the belief that everyone's humanity matters. Make no mistakes, friend. Learning and using NVC, it will make waves at first wherever you use it. Compassion and nonviolence and communication, those are as heretical to the religion of American culture as Unitarianism or Universalism ever was to Christianity. But our faith was founded on heresy. We say what others won't. So talk about your feelings and your needs explicitly and wonder aloud about those of others. In doing so, you honor the feelings and the needs of both of you. You speak the principles of your faith and you contribute to transformation through compassion. Amen and blessed be.
Thank you so much, Lee. Our closing song for today is Down by the Riverside by the great Louis Armstrong.
I'm gonna lay down my sword and shield.
Down by the riverside.
I'm gonna lay down my sword and shield.
Down by the riverside.
I'm gonna study
war no more. War no more.
I ain't gonna study war no more. I'm gonna study war no more. I ain't gonna study war no more.
No more.
I ain't gonna study war no more. Ain't gonna study war no more. I ain't gonna study. Heavy load
down by the riverside.
Oh.
Down by the riverside.
Yeah.
Down by the riverside.
I'm gonna lay down my heavy load
down by the riverside. I'm
gonna study.
Down by the riverside.
Yeah.
Down by the riverside. riverside.
I'm gonna lay down my heavy load
down by the riverside. Gonna study.
As we approach the winter solstice tomorrow, we remember that even as light grows shorter in our days, hope continues. Now, as we extinguish our virtual chalice flame, please read with me these words. When the candle dims, the wax almost spent, the light turns amber like a sunset. Still it provides light, still it provides heat. Still, it can kindle new flame and pass its glow on and contribute to new illumination. When sunsets turn to new days, when seasons transform all, when the candle dims, all is not lost. Hope continues, uncertain and true, like candlelight, ready to spark again. All is not lost. We hope that each of you, on your individual path through the joys and questions of life, found some common ground with your fellow travelers today.
As you go forth this week, amid growing tensions, suffering, and losses, be brave enough to express your feelings and needs directly. Amen and blessed be.
Before we end our service this morning, I have an announcement. Pathways will be making a special Christmas offering to need. COVID and its related economic effects have stretched the supply of food and other items as demand continues to increase. In response, all monies collected for this special offering between December the 13th and the 31st will go to need. To participate, contribute in any of the ways we have available, and be sure to mark your check or the memo line for online donations as Special Christmas Offering for Need. Thank you again, Lee. And we thank each and every one of you for joining us today for our Pathway Zoom service. Now, everyone, feel free to stick around for a few minutes to visit. Our small groups will begin at 11:30. And I'm going to post those resources that Lee mentioned earlier in the chat as well.
And I'm very happy.